الله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله رب واحد وإله واحد قيوم السماوات والأرض، الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم، لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم، له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض، من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه، يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم، ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء، وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض، ولا يؤوده حفظهما، وهو العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن سيدنا ومعلمنا وهادينا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله، هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة، وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. وآخرين منهم لما يلحقوا بهم، وهو العزيز الحكيم، ذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء، والله ذو الفضل العظيم. من يطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا مضل له، ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا هادي له. ومن يعتصم بحبل الله المتين فهو على صراط مستقيم، بإمام مبين. أما بعد، brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, one of the misunderstandings that almost defines the relationship between Muslims and Christians has become a theological dispute over the nature of Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus, the son of Mary. Context and the details of the discussions that go on between Muslims and Christians nowadays are not accurately what they are supposed to be as we understand them from the time of Allah's Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. In these days, the Christians are, or at least those of them who have a religious character to them, are conscious of a historical issue that they refer to as the crucifixion of Jesus and the redemption of mankind. They say that Jesus died for the sins of man. Jesus died so that you and I and the rest of humanity may be expunged of our wrongdoings and our sins. They have maintained this position for hundreds of years, if not for almost 2,000 years. And the Muslims have made it a permanent feature of theirs to try to define our relationship as Muslims with these types of Christians on the basis of this theological difference. We are utterly convinced beyond any doubt that Isa ibn Maryam is Allah's prophet and messenger. He is not the son of God. He is not a part of a trinity. And he is not God himself. There are plentiful ayat expressed by Allah Jalla wa Ala that makes this fact very clear. وقل الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا. And all thanks are due to Allah that He has not adopted, or He has no designated son. لقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله ثالث ثلاثة. Those who say that Allah is one third of three are guilty of denying Him. لقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله ثالث ثلاثة. The Christians, on the other hand, they persist in this theological position attributable to the concept of a trinity. Whatever explanation and whatever theory they pin on to that concept of a trinity. How did Allah's Prophet, alayhi wa alihi salatu wa salam, how did he deal with this issue? Did he present an antagonistic behavior towards these types of individuals or people who are fervently attached to this concept of a trinity? And the answer to that is in his behavior with them. A delegation of Christians came to him. He received them very hospitably. He accommodated them with and understanding. He received them in his masjid in Al-Madinah. And there was no indication at all from the information that we have that during the course of this first interfaith meeting between those who represent Islam and who can represent the Muslims better than Rasulullah, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, and those who represent the Christian religion in this delegation from the southern Arabian Peninsula, from Najran, who came to him. When they exchanged words and ideas, and they reached the issue of whether Isa is the Son of God, and they could not agree on this issue, they, in a friendly manner, Allah's Prophet suggested to them what is called al-mubahala, the invocation of prayers to condemn the side that is not telling the truth pertaining to Isa, whether it's the Muslim side or the Christian side, without any discrimination. And in this friendly exchange of words and interaction of human beings, no one was harsh towards the other, because this was strictly a theological issue. It had nothing to do with matters of war, with economic boycott, with hostilities, with any of these other notions that later on became part of an aggressive history of those who belonged to Christianity against the Muslims. So the question we have today, understanding this, Prophet of Allah said to them, قُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَأَنْفُسَنَا وَأَنْفُسَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. This is a fair, equitable, impartial invocation of a neutral prayer. Let us all pray together that Allah condemn those who are lying. It's not saying condemn you or condemn us. Only the individuals among us who are lying. How fair can you get? But this is not the type of attitude that we have today. Today, Muslims have at least a good number of them who come in contact with theological Christianity, they have a type of internal hostility towards those who express what was expressed exactly to Allah's Prophet. And Allah's Prophet didn't carry that type of hostility towards an errant opinion, towards a very serious mischaracterization and misunderstanding of Allah. There's no hostility. You can refer to any historical reference of your liking, and you will discover that the atmospherics were amicable between the Muslims and the Christians in Al-Madina during the time of Allah's Prophet. So the question is now for us who are trying to live the words of Allah and relive the behavior of His Prophet, why is it that we have Muslims today who begin to make the major difference between Muslims and Christians a theological issue, which cannot be substantiated by ayat from the Quran or by quotes from the Prophet? And the answer to that is a very serious misunderstanding on our behalf of our inter-religious relationship with those who hold to this idea that is in violation of the truth.
Of innocent people, at this time they solicit
elicit from us another set of feelings and another type of response. We cannot take that. And we are justified by Allah Azza wa Jal to stand in opposition to this type of rationalization. How can a president or a commander or anyone else who is leading this charge against Muslims and oppressed peoples in the world, how can he come and say, well, I believe in Jesus, therefore my sins are no longer there, I have been redeemed, and I can do whatever I want to do. What justification is that? This doesn't make any sense. If some of these individuals in Christianity, historical Christianity, not the Christianity of an Injil, if these Christians encountered a difficulty in their heads, they said to their congregations and to the world that man was born with original sin. And they say that God is merciful and God is just. How is God going to forgive us our original sin when he is just? He just can't write it away. There has to be a mechanism for God being a just God and being a merciful God at the same time. And to answer their own question, they contrive this issue of the crucifixion. This was the way to rationalize how God is merciful and how God is just. He sent, they tell us, his only begotten Son who was crucified so that we may not carry the effects of this sin unto the life to come. We don't agree with any of this. We don't agree with it as a whole, and we don't agree with it in its details. We know that we were not born with original sin. We don't come into this life carrying the burden of someone else's mistake. وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No human being, no accountable being is going to be burdened with the responsibilities of another accountable being. وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. By this nafs that we have, and he who has balanced it or harmonized it, inspired it with its alertness of Allah's power, and also with its disregard for the fact of Allah's power. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He who raises this type of nafs is successful, and frustrated is the one who causes this type of nafs to recede. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. And whoever performs one, even an iota of goodness, shall encounter its result, and he who performs even an iota of what is bad shall encounter its result. And the many ayat in the Quran that debunk all of this nonsense about human beings being born with an original sin.
Understand is force and power. They're not willing to take time off reflected their true selves. وَقَتْلِهِمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ. What did they do at one time? They killed these prophets without justification. Who killed Yahya? Who killed Zakaria? Why? Ask yourself, why is this area in scriptural history, why isn't it not filled with enough lively information in our mind? You speak about Yahya being killed and Zakaria being killed. These are Allah's prophets. Who killed them? This is not a theological disagreement here. These are facts. Who killed them? And when we know who killed them, we ask ourselves, why would they want... Why would they want to kill Allah's prophet? وَقَوْلِهِمْ عَلَى مَرْيَمَ بُهْتَانًا عَظِيمًا. And their statement of insult, of limitless insult against Maryam. مريم رسول الله. And their statement that we have killed Isa, the son of Maryam, the messenger of Allah. The Quran and Allah Jalla wa Ala are speaking the fact. This is not no theological issue here. We're not taking them to task because of a theological difference. We are taking them to task for what they did and what they said that they would do. Who said that they killed Isa, the son of Maryam? These are not some fairy tale figures. These are people today who rationalize murder and warfare and genocide and the disruption of lives of millions of people around the world because either they are God's chosen people or because God looks like them. And Muslims, at the end of the day, as if we are living on another planet. Some of us want to get involved in interfaith meetings. We go to them, we sit with them, what do you want to talk about? We already know what Muslims think and are committed to as far as the information that comes from Allah Jalla wa Ala. And we already know the differences and the doubts and the debacles that those who call themselves Christians are in. We already know that. What are you gonna speak about? You can beat a theological issue over and over again, you get nowhere. Because these positions are made of stone. What is not, what is open to discussion and give and take, how much are these who are celebrating nowadays Passover and Easter? What are they doing with their understanding of this relationship with God? You Muslims, whoever goes to these types of meetings, encounter them? How do you explain the ayat that have come to you from Allah with them? It is silly for Muslims who are bleeding to go to these types of meetings and not take that blood with them. Justice is a common denominator among all people. Who's going to run away from the principles controversial. What's too controversial? Muslim blood becoming halal, that has become too controversial. And because we have this theological gap between Muslims and Christians, these troublemakers who want to be seen going into church on Sunday and coming out of church with a Bible in their hand, they come in and they say, oh, where are Muslims and Christians? Where do they live? They live in Bosnia. Well, let's put a match to Bosnia and the Balkans. Muslims and Christians, they live in Lebanon. Throw a match on Lebanon. And it's not only their cries. These politicians, that's what they're made to do. That's what they're right now in the process of doing. But we contribute to that. We Muslims, especially these Muslims who go up on the minbar every Friday and do not inform you with these words from Allah and His Prophet. They are accomplices to these politicians who are committing these types of crimes, of which Musa and Isa and Muhammad and the rest of the prophets have nothing to do with. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, we should understand what Allah is telling us. If we do, then the type of Christianity and Judaism that is practiced by today's people around, we can only look at them as parents will look at some wayward children. Try to take their hand and lead them in the right direction. Show them the way. But if these same children, if they're going to bring explosives and arms and bullets and begin to commit crimes, there is no justification for these crimes in any of Allah's scriptures. But there is justification for the use of force and power for the purposes of establishing an absent justice. Equate the two. If there is now a structure in the world, a power structure, that is killing Muslims, and there are Muslims who are trying to defend themselves, you can't equate one use of force with the other use of force. And they've turned all of this topsy-turvy. As if we are guilty of the use of force, and they are justified in their use of force. This is what happens when nothing is said in Islamic congregation, nothing is taught at Islamic meetings, there is no thinking process in Islamic conferences. This is what happens. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ادعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله تواب رحيم وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون. سيدنا المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه كرمها والفقر. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, these holy days in the civil society that we are geographically a part of,
try and at least a couple of pertinent issues in light of Tawheed and Taqeed. The Islamic firmness of Allah's singularity, Allah's oneness, and Allah's unit.
Whether in society. And if they can split that society, they'll do it. But why should we be contributing to something like that? On another occasion, just a couple of months, two or three months ago, the big item was one of the Christian clergymen, I don't know his exact rank at this moment, his wife wanted to become a Muslim. So, it's the big issue. It's going to be a civil war. We're talking about arms and blood and hundreds, probably thousands, or even tens of thousands of people being killed because of that. It's a non-issue. Muslims, if they understand Allah and His Prophet, do not kill because of theological issues, and they will not be killed because of theological issues. The only time we speak about that type of activity is when that type of converted or perverted theological understanding becomes a justification for wars of aggression and for the shedding of innocent human lives. You would think a religious occasion, a religious holiday, and a religious season would have some impact on people around. But you observe for yourself, is it having any type of impact? Today is what is called Good Friday. The day after tomorrow is Easter. You would think if people are living the meanings of this occasion, even though the meanings we do not agree with at all. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. They did not kill him, meaning Isa, Jesus. They did not crucify him, but they were under the impression that they did. بَلْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. They were under the false impression that they did do that. You would think this type of occasion would cause some people to return to their senses. But no, they go on. They plant bombs here and there. And where is the place? There used to be one of the Henry Kissinger himself. We're not going to disguise our words. Just two or three decades ago, he ignited a civil war among Christians and Muslims in Lebanon. And now they want to return to those dynamics in those days, as if we haven't learned anything in the past 30 to 35 years from the Lebanese experience. They want to take it for granted that they can come in and have Christians open fire on Muslims and Muslims open fire on Christians. And for what reason here? Who is going to be benefiting from this type of internal bleeding in the Muslim body if, may Allah forbid, something like that comes to happen? To whose advantage will this be? يسألك أهل الكتاب أن تنزل عليهم كتابا من السماء فقد سألوا موسى أكبر من ذلك فقالوا أرنا الله جهرة فأخذتهم الصاعقة. These people, they have internalized scripture for their material well-being. They want to make money off the Bible. They want to explain wars of aggression from the Bible. They want to give racism a good name because of the Bible. These types are at it again. They don't go away. They're always there. And we don't expect the shaitan to disappear. identify him, his likes, and their work. Even when we ourselves are bleeding from what they are doing. This is what hurts most of all. On an occasion like this, where is the conscientizing that takes place in the masajid? So Muslims become immune from these types of tricks and shenanigans. How many times are we going to be stung from the same source, killed by the same enemy, fooled by the same politicians? How many times? Countless times if we are removed from Allah and His Prophet. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه ولا تجعله ملتبسا علينا واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير ربنا أخرجنا من هذه القرية الظالم أهلها واجعل لنا من لدنك وليا واجعل لنا من لدنك نصيرا اللهم انصرنا بالحق وانصر اللهم الحق بنا اللهم كن معنا ولا تكن علينا ربنا أكمل لنا نورنا واغفر لنا ربنا اللهم بك نحاول وبك نصاول وبك نقاتل أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء ويجعلكم خلفاء الأرض أإله مع الله قليلا ما تذكرون إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم بارك على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم اللهم بارك على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل إن الله نعما يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا ولذكر الله أكثر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر
اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آت سيدنا محمد الوسيلة والسبيلة الدرجة العالية الرفيعة وآت اللهم مقاما محمودا والحوض المورود كما وعدت الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الامر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله اكبر. الله اكبر. الله اكبر. الله اكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الرحمن الرحيم. مالك يوم الدين. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد. الله الصمد. لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
This is the best one to be in the world. Okay.